Spongiform encephalopathy can be broken down. Spongiform means sponge-like. Encephalo refers to the brain, and path refers to a disease process. So spongiform encephalopathy is a disease where the brain tissue degenerates and healthy tissue gets replaced by clusters of tiny, liquid-filled, thin-walled cavities called cysts, making the brain kind of look like a sponge. The underlying cause of spongiform encephalopathy is the accumulation of misfolded proteins called prions. First, let's review just a tiny bit. Proteins are made up of a long string of amino acids, and the exact sequence of these amino acids is called the primary structure. These long chains of amino acids can fold to form different shapes, like an alpha helix, which is a right-handed coiled strand, and a beta pleated sheet, which is when the chain folds so that the segments line up alongside each other. Each protein can contain multiple alpha helices or beta pleated sheets. Now, there's a protein called prion protein, or PRP, which is encoded by the PRNP gene. This protein is 253 amino acids long, and is made up of mostly alpha helices, and it's most commonly found in the cell membrane of neurons. Although the function of PRP is unknown, it's thought that it might play a role in synapses between neurons and the uptake of copper into the cell. When a prion protein is misfolded, it changes from mostly having alpha helices to having a lot of beta-pleated sheets. This new abnormal protein is called a prion. When the misfolded protein enters the cells of the nervous system and interacts with the normal prion protein, it acts as a template and induces misfolding in the normal prion proteins. These prions are also highly resistant to being broken down by proteases, which are the enzymes that break down abnormal proteins. As a result, these misfolded prion proteins cannot be easily broken down. They also cause normally folded proteins to misfold and become just like them. And they have an affinity for the brain. They're basically like little beta sheet-filled zombies. These misfolded prions accumulate within the cell and trigger apoptosis, which is programmed cell death. This is done with the help of 14-3-3 protein, which is an intracellular protein that promotes apoptosis. When large numbers of cells start to die off, cysts start to form in the brain, and over time, this gives the brain its spongy appearance. Additionally, the prions aggregate together on the membrane of the neurons, forming large plaques that are toxic to brain tissue. Now, the most common cause of spongiform encephalopathy is Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, or CJD, and there are actually four types of CJD: familial or FCJD, variant or VCJD, iatrogenic or ICJD, and sporadic or SCJD. All four types cause spongiform degeneration of the cerebral cortex and cerebellum. Familial Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease happens when there's a mutation in the PRNP gene. The most common mutation happens at the 200th codon and causes the amino acid glutamic acid to be replaced by a lysine, and that's enough to make the entire protein misfold. Variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease is caused by eating the meat of cows with prions in the muscle tissue. In cows, these prions cause bovine spongiform encephalopathy, which is more commonly called mad cow disease. When sheep are fed cow meat, the prion causes the disease scrapie. If a person eats the meat of affected cows or sheep, the prions get absorbed through the intestines into the bloodstream. After that, things get a bit unclear. It's thought that the protein can somehow get through the blood-brain barrier and then enter the neurons by a process called adsorptive endocytosis. Adsorptive endocytosis is a process where the plasma membrane of nerve cells folds inward to bring in substances that would otherwise not be able to cross the plasma membrane by themselves. Furthermore, since the misfolded proteins are in the blood of individuals with variant CJD, if they try to donate blood, the prions can get transmitted to recipients of the blood, which can spread the disease. In fact, people in the UK who have received a blood transfusion since January 1980 are banned from donating blood for that very reason. Iatrogenic Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease is caused by medical procedures, like when equipment for a procedure like a corneal transplant gets contaminated and infects healthy individuals. Finally, there's sporadic Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, which pops up in populations randomly without a clear cause. This could be due to a spontaneous mutation in the 129th codon in the PRNP gene that replaces valine with methionine. People with this mutation are more likely to develop sporadic Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease and are also more susceptible to variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Another type of spongiform encephalopathy is kuru, which is spread through cannibalism of infected flesh. In other words, when an individual eats the human flesh of an infected individual. Kuru famously affected a tribe in New Guinea who ate the brains of deceased family members. And in this way, the misfolded prion proteins pass from person to person. Since the symptoms are similar to those with Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, it's suspected that kuru started when one of these tribes' people acquired sporadic Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Another disease is fatal familial insomnia, which is also caused by a mutation in the PRMP gene at codon 178, where aspartic acid is substituted with asparagine. An interesting example of two different clinical diseases developing from different mutations in the same gene. In fatal familial insomnia, misfolded prion proteins build up mainly in the neurons of the thalamus that helps regulate sleep, rather than causing the typical spongiform degeneration of the cerebral cortex and cerebellum that happen in other prion diseases. Symptoms of spongiform encephalopathy might not show up for decades after prions have entered or formed in the body. But once symptoms start developing, they tend to progress rapidly, resulting in death within a year. Early symptoms for Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease and kuru involves motor symptoms like ataxia, which is defined as lack of coordination of voluntary muscles, and neurological symptoms like poor memory and behavioral changes. Later stage symptoms include muscle weakness that make it difficult to walk or stand, and myoclonus, which is quick, jerky movement of the muscles. Hiccups are an example of myoclonus. Finally, there's dementia, which is where a person loses their mental functions like memory, decision-making, and reasoning. Lastly, in fatal familial insomnia, people present with early symptoms of insomnia and an exaggerated startle response. Eventually, they cannot sleep at all and can experience hallucinations. Like the other prion diseases, they eventually develop dementia, and it eventually progresses to death. Spongiform encephalopathy is diagnosed based on symptoms and MRI findings, which include lesions in the cortex, basal ganglia, and thalamus. A lumbar puncture can also be done to get cerebrospinal fluid, which might show elevated levels of 14-3-3 protein, which is a sign of significant neuronal destruction. Ultimately, the definitive diagnosis of spongiform encephalopathy is done with a brain biopsy, which is typically done after a person dies. There are currently no treatments for prion diseases. Supportive care should be given and genetic counseling should be offered for those with familial forms of the disease. It's best to prevent transmission of the prions by restricting blood donation from those with the disease and thoroughly decontaminating surgical equipment. Alright, as a quick recap. Spongiform encephalopathy is a degenerative brain disease caused by the accumulation of misfolded prion proteins. This degeneration gives the brain a spongy appearance, and is seen in diseases like Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease and kuru. Prions can be transmitted by eating infected meat, blood transfusion, corneal transplants, and contaminated surgical instruments. There is no treatment for these diseases, and they always result in dementia and eventually death, so prevention of transmission is the key management strategy of the disease.
Hey y'all, hope you enjoyed our video on spongiform encephalopathy and prions. If I'm being honest, and I am, I only knew a tiny bit about this one going into it. I knew it had something to do with cannibalism and something to do with zombies, and it was really interesting to find out the specifics of how those two things connected. And speaking of the specifics, the script for this video was written by Demolola and then edited by Yifan and Rishi, and then Kara did the illustrations, Tanner did the voiceover, and I did the video editing. And man, this one was interesting. You know, people say, oh, he retains so much information, he's got a brain like a sponge. Well, I'm never going to be able to hear that phrase again without thinking of the literal implications of someone's brain being like a sponge. It's a little terrifying. Oh, man. But if you want to watch one of our other videos on maybe a lighter subject than this one, go over to osmosis.org and you can find over 100 videos that are exclusive to our Prime service, or you can check out the shop. We got more things coming down the line, so stay tuned for those and stay tuned to the channel for more videos similar to this one. Bye.